Hello, welcome to Footprint. My name is Samuel Atamensa. We'll take a short break, and when we come back, we'll be zooming in straight into our conversation with our guest for today. Welcome back. This is Footprint. Now you know who we are having on the program today, Alhaji Mohammed Nuruddin Jaula. This is a name that is so familiar with any young man, young woman that grew up in Ghana in the 80s and most parts of the 90s. Very familiar name, was always in the news for the right reasons. In fact, I even thought that his full-time job was just a sports administrator. It turned out not to be true. We are going to find out. Alhaji, good to see you.
Yeah, I used to be Alhaji, but precisely I'm not Lepora.
Okay.
That's my title.
Are they, they are not.
Well, the Alhaji was a title that I got for myself, having gone on pilgrimage to Hajj.
Okay.
But thereafter,
when you become a chief?
Yes, 2006, I became a chief.
So and chiefs then, don't use...
No, I combine the two. You can call me Lepora Alhaji. I have no objection.
Okay, it's so fine. Lepora Alhaji Mohammed Nuruddin Jaula.
Like the Nigerians like to do.
They bring if you bring Nigeria, we'll end today. Because now I have to stand up. Thank you, Alhaji.
I appreciate it.
It's just how the name has been sold over the years. In the media, Alhaji Jaula, you know, but Lepora. Now, what is Lepora? Help me.
Lepora actually is a title from Gonja. The title Wura, you know, is from Gonja. We are Gwans. You know, the Gonjas are the largest ethnic group of all the of all the Gwans, and we all use the title Wura. Wura is the title for chief or owner, okay. As it were. But me precisely. Coming from the Kwembe traditional area, the Lepora is like the chief of staff of the Kwembe Wura.
Okay.
I'm the chief of staff of the paramount chief of the Kwembe division.
Oh, wow.
So Lepo actually, to bring it down to earth, is the owner of the soups. It means I control the chief's kitchen.
Oh, okay.
I must bring him the soup, I must bring him the wealth, I must bring him everything that makes him comfortable.
So does that give you a role in the palace, as in functional role?
Oh, definitely. I believe the Lepora is the most important traditional ruler after the Kwembe Wura in the palace.
Okay. So administratively, what is required of the Lepora?
Administratively, I just finished one when there's a festival, and there's a need for any duty like giving up a sheep. A cow, whatever, that is my work to do.
So Alhaji, tell me, were you born in the Salaga area yourself?
No, incidentally, I would say that the paths crossed, the paths of my father and my mother crossed. My mother coming out of Accra, Kowloon, to be precise, Jamestown.
Ghana woman?
Yes, Ghana. Her father of Hausa ancestry and her mother of Ghana.
Okay. Then so this will be the Nigerian mixed with Ghana.
Mixed with, exactly.
Of course. That's then very common.
Yeah, very common. That's the Shadow family.
Oh, very popular in Accra.
Very famous. Her brother was the one of Kwame Nkrumah's right hand men, J.B. Shadow, a great man who headed the Ghana Young Pioneer Movement. And then for a little, he was even MP for Tema. And then my father came from Gonja, and he was, as we said, he was then a malam in Accra, working for high-profile institutions like Accra House of Folk. He was among the first malams.
He was a footballer?
No, he was a malam of Accra House of Folk. He was a...
Well, he used to do what for them? I mean, a malam, yes, as we call it.
He was doing that spiritual work, which I believe they have not stopped doing up to today. I believe strongly.
Ah, all the clubs, spiritual work.
All the clubs do it, my brother.
Yeah, but you require it. No, I'm trying to draw you into it.
Don't worry, whether it works or not, everybody does it.
Really?
Well, let me even say, even Brazilians and South Americans do it. Yes, because I took RTU in those days to Korea in 1986, and we had to play a match against Uruguay. They spent all the night praying under candles. I can assure you.
Who did?
Uruguay national team.
Uruguay. And they won?
2-1. I played on our side, but it was tough. And Livka Ede and others were asked to come and support RTU to play against them. They won 2-1. They spent all the night praying and they were into all sorts of incantations throughout the night.
And it works?
Well, it means it works.
It's just psychological.
Well, that was the thing, but the players believe in it.
Let me just digress. So you have, of course, you know football inside out. The English league, for instance, spiritual stuff.
Let me tell you what happens in the English league. Mm-hmm. There are some players within the English league. Their names don't come out clearly, but I'm sure our viewers, some of them may know, who must sit in a certain part of the dressing room before every match. Otherwise, they will not go out to play. I can assure you. There are some players. They must sit at a certain particular corner of the dressing room because it is said that some player in the past always sat there and made it very well.
That is understandable.
But what's the difference between the two? It's the same thing.
Anyway, so your dad, Hearts of Folk,
yes,
Malam.
They know it. And then,
I'm very interested. I'm a Hearts of Folk supporter.
Oh, so, I didn't know this.
So please forgive. So officially, they recognize him as such, or?
Yes, he used to travel with the team. He told me. Long after, of course, he went back to the North, he was the chief, yeah. And so on.
Wow. But as a young boy growing up, your father having had this kind of penetration with Hearts of Folk, one would have expected that you grow up being a supporter of Hearts of Folk.
Yes, I was initially Hearts of Folk.
Oh, okay. It makes
sense. And then let me tell you a bit more. I know the program.
No, don't worry.
Some people say, what's all this happening? If people are working from Kotoko, they say, what is this Hearts of Folk worrying us today? You know, I was living in the same house as Mama Akwa.
Mama Akwa?
Exactly, the great Mama
Akwa. Wow.
And I used to play football with him in Malata.
Wow.
But of course, I was not up to his level.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So.
Malata, the market?
The market. It was then a park for us as we grew up in Accra.
Before it became the market, the market was a small market.
Oh, yeah. It was a small market. We were playing
behind
on the
Oxford
side.
Cinema.
Exactly.
Right?
We were playing behind Oxford Cinema.
Yeah.
And so on. And when in those days, whenever Accra House of Folk came to Tamale, I used to support them.
Mm-hmm.
Until I was discovered for RTU.
Much later.
Yeah, much later. And then, of course, I put at you. And let me tell you something interesting. Inter Hearts of Folk came to Tamale, secretly, I just felt that we should draw the game. But whatever it was, Kotoko, I said, we have to beat these people. So that interest was there.
Nice.
But of course, later on, when you get to the GFA, you know that Kotoko has a very temerary role to play in the in the flight of football in this country, and you must respect them. And when they do well, Ghana football generally does very well.
Okay. Well, I don't know much about this, but I know Phobia does well, and we are all excited. Kotoko does well, and Kumasi people are excited.
No, it's a national team.
You didn't hear that from me. Solaji, where did you start your elementary education?
Yeah, I started from Kwandai Primary School, Kwandai Middle Primary School, where my father was the chief in Kwandai.
Oh, so you left Accra?
I was born here in Accra in 1949. And according to my mom, I was in Accra for about 3 years, here growing with my grandma. And my mother went to the north initially, then they came back and sent me to the north.
And so what was your grandma doing?
Oh, she was a petty trader in Makola.
What was Makola like?
Oh, Makola was something. I used to play with a lot of my grand brothers and sisters. I don't know where they are today.
Oh, yeah.
And in the evening, I would go and hold the gate to the market.
Yeah, you know, the big gate.
The big gate.
Yeah.
They used to close the gate to the market.
I know.
Can you believe this? No, times have changed. And so when I went to the village in Kwandai, they said every evening, when it was getting to dusk, I would go and hold the gate to the house and say, it's time to leave the market. And everybody was wondering, what is this guy about? Yeah. The other said, he's closing the gate to the market. And so, definitely, I grew up in the market with her. And later, I was sent to Pandai Primary. And I enjoyed school very much, very, very much. I enjoyed school. primary and middle, because my mother, having come out of Accra to the north, knew the value of education, and she did everything for me to make it to the highest level.
So at this time, what language were you speaking?
Well, initially Hausa. Initially Ghana with my mother.
Okay.
And that vanished very
fast. Of course, the influences.
Okay, that vanished very fast, and then later on, a bit of Hausa and then Gonja, of course.
Right. So the Ghana, you dropped the Ghana.
It's not totally dropped. When people think they are speaking about me, I hear everything anyway.
But you smile.
I just smile and say nothing.
Because at least they don't insult you.
Well, when they insult you, I tell them I've heard them.
Because as for guys, they'll just drop one.
Just like that, yes.
Okay, so growing up, you know, Pandai, and where did you do secondary education?
Tamale Secondary School, the famous Tamale Secondary School.
Tell me, Tamale Secondary School, some of your fondest memories.
Great school. Out of prejudice, let me say, perhaps the best school in Ghana.
Wow, for real, that's your experience.
I know Achimota and Fasifim, Wesley guys will not like to hear it. I've friends who are watching, I'm sure, from those schools who say, well, what is he talking about?
Now, who feels it knows it.
But it was a great school. Mm. This was a school founded by the British, precisely in 1951. And we were lucky, we went there 10 years after its foundation, after it was founded. In 1961, I was there. We met some of the white people. Mr. Cunningham was then the headmaster. In fact, I was interviewed by Mr. Southern, who was a white man. He came to Pandai to interview us in those days. And then we got to admission. And when I came to Form 1, Mr. Southern had left for England. Mr. Cunningham, who was called a London boy, was then the headmaster. It was when he left that we had the first black headmaster of the school, Mr. Boateng. Sir Boateng, who later on became the Director General of the Ghana Education Service, and after him, Mr. Uredu, and some of the best people, Alhaji Badamosi, and the rest of them,
Oh, Alhaji Badamosi too taught in
Alhaji Badamosi was the first senior principal of Tamale Secondary School.
Wow.
He's a very historical man.
Yeah.
He was the first senior principal of Tamale School. Later on, came back and taught in the school, taught physics, went for his master's, came back, was senior headmaster, was later on as headmaster, was headmaster for several years, was Regional Director of Education and North,
and was Director General. For many years.
And wow. And he made up, he made Tamale School great. He died a few years ago, and I had to put pressure, and he put in the book for him to write about Northern education and about Tamale School, and he did very well. And so that record,
you know,
is there.
Growing up, I always thought that the Badamosi name had a Nigerian connection.
Oh definitely.
Yeah.
Principally, he was Yoruba.
Yeah.
But they were born and bred in Wa.
Oh, okay.
So okay. He saw himself as a Wala.
That's correct.
And indeed, his accent was very Wala.
Yeah.
So he would not speak without saying Bunga, Bunga. Bunga is in Wa. Is in Wale.
Oh, okay.
For distant, you know, he was. But principally, he was a Wala man.
Great guy.
Yes.
And who else, some of the notable names that you remember?
Many, many people. The late lawyer Bawo Diaka, the one, the General Amidu, who just died.
Yeah, Joshua.
Joshua Amidu was the second batch. He and my senior brother were classmates. Of course, others like Kenneth Feli, Kenneth Minila.
Oh, so you're talking about Kenneth Feli?
They're all Tamaskans. Yes, Mila. Wow. So many.
And Kenel Minyila.
Yes, most of these big names.
I mean, these guys can define.
Kenel Ibisa.
Yeah. So we'll take a short break. When we come back, Alhaji Jaola will take us through his stint, his experience at the time. Four years in Cape Coast University. Somebody born in Accra, had his growing up in the north, having been to the UK. Now coming into another space where he's going to have to interact with people from different parts of Ghana. This is still Footprint. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the program, and we are having a chat with Lepura Alhaji MND Jaola. This name stands for many things in public life, you know, is being a public servant, done experience to the highest level, is a football administrator, is you know, some patriot, he's been everything that you can think, and now he's a chief. And so, Alhaji, so coming back from England, what program did you read there, set form? What courses?
Yeah, I read English economics.
In England?
Yeah, in public affairs.
Oh,
in history.
Oh wow!
I did,
but yeah. that was like taking you straight into law then.
Oh yes, I should have been that law because I did. They had what they call economics and public affairs, like economics and the constitution put together.
Okay.
And the history was the
European history.
15th history for English history, Tudors and the Stuarts, and the European history, 16th century,
mm-hmm.
For the European part of the history. Very 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 deep.
Because, you know, you say with all modesty, but in England, those would be the courses that people struggle yeah. to do if they wanted to get into.
Yeah, and most of my colleagues got the level of the school, went to Cambridge and Oxford.
Of course.
And in those days, if I'd stayed back, perhaps I'd have joined them because, as it used to be in those days, Cambridge and Oxford would come around the schools
and
do their recruitment even before you wrote the exams.
Yeah.
And convince you to pick those universities before. But then the best advice I was given, and which made sense, was that young man, if you go back to your country,
mm-hmm.
people who have stayed back have found themselves in the wrong places later.
Wow.
Yeah. So
sad.
So I just had to come
and
back.
And it paid off.
It definitely. I hope so.
Wow.
Hope it did. Yes. I hope it did.
So now you entered University of Cape Coast.
Yes.
Which year would this be?
I did went of Cape Coast precisely in 1968, soon after sixth form,
mm-hmm.
and I read English history and economics.
Wow.
Yeah, and of course I dropped the history, and then I added education.
Of course, it was required at the time. Yeah.
In my last 2 years,
mm-hmm.
and came out as a teacher, and went back to Tamale Secondary School, and taught for 2 years, and then went back to the University of Ghana to do my master's.
In what?
In African literature.
Okay. Now, tell me your experiences in Cape Vars at the time, you know. Very at the time, was relatively a smaller university as compared to KNUST and University of Ghana, right?
Very interesting experiences. First of all, the biggest news was that by the end of the first year, I had become the president of the National Union of Ghana Students.
Huh?
Yes.
Yes. First year student?
At the end of the first year, yes. And it was big. And I remember
you were Nook's president?
I was Nook's president. And and I will tell you among some of my contemporaries,
mm-hmm.
as I'll put it. Mm-hmm. At that time in KNUST, the president of the SRC was the late P.V. Oben.
Oh, okay.
And at that time, the secretary of Nook's KNUST branch was Nana Kunedu Ajman Rawlings. Can you believe this? These were the people that we have a meeting with as students in those days.
Yeah.
And people like Abdullah Chogu and people like that and other people like that. We had Magnus Nsufu then coming out of Legon. And we were very radicalized.
Paul Victor Bain and Nana Kunedu Ajman Rawlings from KNUST.
Yes.
And then which are
Magnus Nsufu, then he was secretary from
University of Ghana.
University of Ghana. Then Paul Adigefi.
Okay.
It's a big time lawyer now who was the president for University of Ghana and so on. And we're all working together in those days.
But you were in first year.
Yeah, I didn't know the first
or
year.
Or second year.
Yeah, yeah, sort of. Yeah. Yes.
It was, you had the boldness to contest or there was nobody?
No, lots of people. I'll tell you what happened. I was in the room one day when my senior there was, I'm sure he will not remember, Kwesi Ahoy was my senior.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Kwesi Ahoy.
Yeah, in Cape Coast. And then he came to my room and said, look, he said, Jaola, everybody thinks that you should contest for this sort of thing. Hey, how do I contest? Just the population there was less than 100. He said, no, we shall support you. You know, said, a lot of people think that you should contest for this position. So I went in for it and I won. It was huge. And We were the radicals.
Which hall were you?
In the war hall.
Ogwa Hall. Okay.
And I'll tell you about this thing. My lecturers were radicals. Would you believe Amate was my lecturer in English?
Mm-hmm.
And she was very radical. Atabrichum, those who know him, French, he was a big radical. And they were those who were encouraging me to take this place up. When Nkrumah died, we walked barefooted to the center of Cape Coast to demand that Nkrumah's body should be brought to Ghana for burial, because at that time, the government was being stubborn. Yeah. I have some of the pictures, very amazing. Yeah. We're joined by one Musa Biteye, who became Attorney General of Gambia.
Mm-hmm.
What great people.
Yeah.
A lot of great
and they're
people.
All students.
Students.
Yeah.
Yes. And these guys joined us. So the pictures are quite interesting. And then we were quite happy.
But I find that intriguing for so first year student to be not SRC secretary, but
yeah,
looks.
Yeah, but well, looks, looking for possibly somebody who was a bit outward. I was very loud in debates.
Oh,
on campus.
Because you must have had something.
Yeah, I was very loud in debates on campus, and generally. I enjoyed campus. You can imagine somebody coming out of England.
Exactly the point I was going to make.
My English was better than now.
Oh!
so you can imagine.
You spoke with some style.
So you can imagine. You can imagine all the things that I could say. And my classmates had a lot of respect for me in the poetry class. So this man was ahead. What's the secret? They didn't know I'd done all these poems in England. Oh. And I could picture the snow, the winter, the tulips, and all the things that they were now reading books, but I felt them, you know. So naturally, I had a bit of advantage over them.
So there you had you have some real fond memories of Kibas.
Excellent, and the campus generally.
Yeah,
we used to spend my time at the beach, preparing for examinations, and things really stuck in our heads.
Oh, nice.
And I thought we did well.
So later on, you went to do your masters in University of Ghana. It must have been boring.
Well, in fairness, I don't want my friends.
No, I'm the one saying it. So
I know. I say in fairness, I don't want my friends in Saba to condemn me. But Master Saba was nice. There, of course, I had colleagues like at Austin.
Oh, you met at Austin there?
Yes.
Doing his master's at the time.
Or he met me. Well,
you were there together.
We met each other. Mm-hmm. Ibn Chambers was there. The late vice president of Ghana, Ibn Sata, he was then doing his first degree when I was doing my master's.
Oh.
Then Mrs. Betty Bolimutu Idrisu was also there.
Doing her first degree?
She was doing her first degree.
Mm-hmm.
And
How fate has it? You later on met Emisata, the finance ministry.
Interesting, and we were very good friends. You know, I'll tell you, Emisata then, he was then in either in Legon or Kwafo Hall, and he used to come and visit his wife that he eventually married in Saba Hall.
Mm-hmm.
And we used to meet in the Porter's Lodge and have a lot of conversations.
Oh.
You know, so eventually when he came back, first of all as a special assistant to the Minister of Finance, and later on as a Deputy Minister of Finance, we're on very good terms because we had met on campus and we're on very good terms.
Great. So tell me, so finishing your master's, how did you end up in the public service?
Yeah, as soon as I left my master's program, I applied to join the civil service.
Hmm.
It was a bit challenging because I just felt that teaching was good. I enjoyed teaching, to be honest with you. I enjoyed teaching, especially teaching in Tamasco. It was a big challenge, and Alhaji Benuosi, he was then the headmaster, put me in charge of so many things. I was in charge of the examinations of the school, internal and external. I was master in charge of the choral society. Will you believe a Muslim? But I was doing a choral society. I was in charge of it.
Wow.
I was in charge of the school magazine. I was in charge of in the school, I started some publication, The Dynamite, that talked about school activity, training some of the students. And I enjoyed it entirely. I was a housemaster, I was a form master. I had so much to do on my hands. So for those 2 years, I was a very busy man.
This time, were you married? At that time?
I was. At the time I came to Moscow, I just got married in 73 because I came in 72. and I got married in 73. And then what I didn't say was that in Tamasco, I was the assistant senior prefect. Later on, I became the senior prefect.
Wow.
So coming on to come and teach and be housemaster was just like a continuation of life in the school. And so it's no surprise that today I'm the board chairman of the school.
Oh, you are.
So everything of me is
Tamasco for life. Yeah. Oh, nice. So, civil service. Where did you start from?
I have an interesting story about the civil service. Mm-hmm. I started in the civil service as what they call assistant secretary. I started from Tamale, Western Dagumba. At that time, there were four districts now that were under Western Dagumba. Sorry, I started from Eastern Dagumba, Yendi. At that time, all those districts like Zabzugu, Tatale, and Bushagu, Yendi, they were all under one district, Eastern Dagumba. From there, I moved to Western Dagumba, Tamale. That was Tamale, Tolong, Kubungu. They were all under Western Dagumba. Then, in those days, you had to have a break and go back to Gimpa to do a postgraduate diploma in public administration. So I did that and came back. And from there, I was posted to Wale Wale to start a new district. So I started the district in Wale Wale. It was then under Gambaga. But I came and started the district in Wale Wale as a DC. In those days, DCs were civil servants.
Yeah.
They picked us and then we ran the place. From Wale Wale, I was posted back to Gambaga to head a bigger district.
Which year would this be again?
1979, I opened the district in Wale Wale. Mm-hmm. By 1980, I was in Gambaga. And I worked 80 to 83 and moved back to Tamale.
Still as DC?
Yes, still at DC. Mm-hmm. And did a couple of years. In 1988, August, I won another bursary this time, the Lester Pearson Fellowship to go to the University of Ottawa and Carlton, in Ottawa in Canada. I say Ottawa because if you say Ottawa, it doesn't make sense to
No, we America. Say Ottawa, but no, you can deal with that, the Ottawa.
if my Canadian friends hear me, they say, has the man deteriorated?
We are happy with the Ottawa like that too.
you know, this is funny, but let me share this joke on the public domain. I met somebody some time ago. He said, oh, I was in Canada. So where were you? I was in the University of Ottawa. I said, no. I said, I'm sorry, you're not there.
You're not there.
I mean, you were nowhere near there.
That sounds painful, man.
It's like somebody said, I was in the University of Ghana. You said, which hall? He said, in the Volta Hall, a man. That was not possible.
So you went back, you went to Canada for another master's program?
Yeah, it was actually a fellowship.
A fellowship.
It's
okay.
A bit between master's and PhD. Mm-hmm. Lester Pearson Fellowship was a program designed by former president of Canada, one of the most respected prime ministers, Lester Pearson. And then every year in those days, they interviewed 14,000 people from the third world and they selected 14 people. That was terrible. And I did the interview in Senegal and God willing, I had it. And you were allowed to go there with your wife and up to three or four children.
Mm.
Yeah, big bursary. And you were paid good money, over $2,500 a month. And it was very comfortable.
Mm-hmm. With accommodation and
everything. You had everything. And you did a good program.
So and that I was for back. How long? 2 years?
Oh, no, just a year.
A year.
Yeah, and then I came back and continued in the civil service. So this is an interesting aspect of the civil service. When I came back to Tamale, I thought that I would be used very well because here was a guy who had left after professional trainings. I had gone to add a bit more in development administration. But when I came, I was hardly used. And the next thing I heard was that I was being posted from Tamale to the Tolan district. I didn't find that very desirable. I couldn't understand it because I was serving in Tamale and I was happy. Side by side, of course, I was running RTU. So many things were working for me. And when I came, I had hardly any schedule in the office. One day, they said they were posting me to Tolong. I said, okay. So my colleague who brought the announcement said, so are you going to Tolong? I said, yes, I'm going to Tolong. They said, you go to Tolong. What can I do?
Mm-hmm.
So I agreed I went to Tolong. And as fate would have it, I'm saying something for the first time that the person will be surprised that he was behind many things. Kwame Nahoy came on a visit to Tolong as the Minister of Local Government.
And Secretary then, at the time.
Secretary of Local Government. And then I organized everything about Tolong, the assembly meetings and everything. I spoke at assembly and organized. Then one thing, he called me aside. I was not a chief, but he was a chief. You know, they like to show a sign of respect. He said, "Chief, why are you here?" So I said, "Well, this is where we posted to." "No, that Tolong looks a bit small for you." That's what he told me, based on what I've seen on your performance. Not knowing at that time, he was also re-engineering the personnel administrators around. He was thinking about what to do to do so many things. So he said, "No, no. What is your background?" I told him. "I just came from Canada." "What did you study?" I said, "Oh, I did development economics." "Like what?" "Set adjustment, microeconomics, macroeconomics, computers." I said, "So many things." He said, "No, no, no. Let me talk to Dr. Butchie about you." So he talked to Dr. Butchie. Dr. Butchie said, "I should be better for an interview in Accra." I came to Accra. The first day I couldn't meet him, he was very busy. But the second day I met Dr. Butchie, he said, "No, I haven't spoken to you. You should be at the Ministry of Finance." That's how I got to the Ministry of Finance.
Wow.
Very interesting. I'm sure Ahoy will not remember this. Because if he watches, then he will remember. So I owe a lot to him.
Wow.
And I respect him for everything.
This is Kwame Nahoy.
Yeah, Kwame Nahoy.
Okay. But he didn't know that you were in school with Kwesi prior to this.
He didn't know all this.
Mm-hmm.
He just assessed me.
That's correct.
No, I have a lot of respect for
so
him.
So tell me, at which point did football come into? You just mentioned RTU.
Yeah, when I was in Wale Wale, as I said, I started a club called Wale Wale Holala. The people of Wale Wale, some would remember, some would not remember.
Wale Wale Holala.
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 Yes, Holala. We just call it Wale Wale Holala. Mm-hmm. And we were making quite an imprint within that area of Ghana. Between Wale Wale then, that was in the Imamputi West District, and Bogatanga and Boku, we used to go and play a lot of matches. We made a very big impact. So one occasion, I said to invite RTU to come to Wale Wale. I thought we had reached there. I thought we were a great team. I went to RTU with the likes of Cho, Mohamed Dauda, and all those guys. Tanko Jetuma, Clifford Adai, Mumuni Gamel, Damba Bukari.
Yeah, the goalkeeper.
Yes, they came to Wale Wale and trounced us 5-0.
Oh la la.
Oh la la indeed. So they trounced us 5-0. And then, so naturally, my attention was brought to the club. So when I got posted back to Tamale and there was reorganization, there was pressure from the late Gbenemosi and B.F. Hussaini that I should be brought on board as the vice chairman of RTU.
Mm.
That's how I entered RTU.
Wow.
They felt that I had a passion, yeah. Inviting them all the way. I invited them. They spent the day in Wale Wale. We looked after them very well, entertained them to local dejis and dances and so on. The place felt very good. So they felt that I could do something for RTU.
Mm.
That's how I got into football.
And how was it working with RTU at the time?
It was quite tough. The good thing was that...
Which division would there be at the time?
No. Who went then Premier...
First division. Okay.
And
this is now 80s.
In the 80s. Mm. And I'll tell you other things that will bring your mind back to it. At that time, Arinya Mensah was Huduyaya, Alhaji Huduyaya.
Mm-hmm.
And he gave me a lot of authority over the club, a lot of support through businessmen and the rest. And we lifted the club very high. In 1986, to be precise, we had this crucial match at UV's House of Oak that was going to decide the league champion. And I believe that if you're a true House of Oak match, you remember that match, people were hanging on all one of you to watch this match. I don't think that we've had such a crowd in Accra ever that much, ever. And then we were so sure of our team. Why? Because in our post then, we had John Baker.
Mm-hmm.
You can imagine who was
John
there.
Baker was the RTU?
After he left the Black Stars, uh-huh, and he was inactive,
okay,
we recruited him to RTU,
oh, okay,
as a goalkeeper.
Oh, nice.
And he even turned them back another little. And it was so nice. The match was big, and we lost because one guy, the name will come soon. Butchery scored a goal against us.
Own goal?
No. He scored against us. He has a good player, mm-hmm. managed to score the only goal of the match.
Yeah.
There are so many stories about that spiritual match. I can't say all here. There are so many spiritual points to that match. Among them, a supporter swore that Butchery would never play football again. I don't know about that, but we haven't heard of him again since that match. Where he is now, I have no idea.
Somebody might tell around, him. He's around.
He's around, but not in football. I mean,
most of them, man.
Wow. So, yes, it was a tough match. Mm. And, quite recently, history repeated itself. Kotoko played Akaraso Fouk, and they said Laye was the referee. But it's not news. When we played the match against Asopo, his grandfather, Elo Laye, was the referee in that match. From Accra.
Uh-huh.
But he had quality.
Yeah.
And we knew he would not rubber. And he didn't rubber. It was a clean match. Yeah. The same way, I think, Haspet is Kotoko. His grandson, Laye, did a similar job.
Yeah.
And has won.
And we won, yeah.
By the same margin.
We won clean, yeah.
Uh-huh. Well, I'm not sure that it was clean.
If I double,
I'm telling you.
The big territory for
yes,
you,
yes,
and
yes,
you know,
yes.
playing with the big names,
yes,
and
yes.
you know. Okay, so we'll just have a short break, come back, and we'd like to know how he maneuvered his way at that senior level in the ministry, and now how he ended up with the Ghana Football Association. This is Footprint. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the program. This is Footprint, and you are definitely watching City TV. My name is Samuel Atamensa, and I have Alhaji M.N.D. Jaula, the Lepura. Yeah, Lepura. I need to look for one of these titles and go and live up north for some time. But this Lepura thing, I love it. Alhaji, so now that you find yourself at the finance ministry, at this time, you'll be there as a director, or
I came there as a deputy director.
Deputy director.
Yeah, from Tamale.
Mm-hmm. And what would be your role?
In 1990, and I was then in the Department of General Administration under the late Mr. Ayete.
Mm-hmm.
And my chief director was Mr. Ibe Sean. And Mr. Hagan, there are two chief directors, Mr. Hagan and Mr. Ibe Sean.
Yeah.
And at that time, Dr. Butchery was the Minister of Finance.
Mm-hmm.
I've served under Dr. Butchery and other ministers.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you rose through the ranks also to become a chief director.
Yeah. From there, I got my promotion to director in the ministry, headed the ministry as head of administration of the Ministry of Finance.
Mm-hmm.
From there, I went to become a chief director at the Ministry of Harbours and Railways when Ministry of Transport was split. Mm-hmm. And for the Ministry of Harbours and Railways, I ended up at the Ministry of Health as the chief director.
Wow. You should write a book on the public service in
definitely
Ghana someday. And how to survive.
it's my mind sometimes.
Yeah, you should. Anyway, so, but interestingly, while you were here, you wore two hats. Alhaji Jaula football, Ghana football, you know, obviously with your background from RTU, and the Wali Wali Ho Lala, is that?
Exactly.
Yeah, Wali Wali Ho Lala. Yeah, keep that name, it's nice. RTU, Real Tamale United, and then Black Stars, GFA. How did you get into GFA? Is it because you were with...
Yeah, RTU? While I was in the Ministry of Finance, I was one of the representatives of RTU. My good friend Jones Abu Alas and I were
Jones, yeah.
Yes,
he also had something to do with RTU.
Yes, mm-hmm. He was a car rep like me in those mm-hmm. days. So there was a chance for an election to the position of membership of the GFA.
Mm-hmm.
So I went into the election, first time, and I won to come as a member to support Nana Bartlett's administration. And while I was
as a member initially. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Then we had a vice. His name doesn't come up quickly, but he used to work with Gassim. Okay. And then I had other people like Ohinba Charles and others who were there with me.
Ohinba Charles, who was a sports writer.
Yeah, the journalist. Yeah. And so it came to a time when this vice chairman and Nana Butler had a clash and he had to go. So Nana suggested to me if I could be his vice, and I said, why not? So that's how I became the vice chairman of Nana Butler.
Okay.
So I served under him all the issues.
GFA vice chairman.
About the Pele's days. Mm-hmm. And eventually I took the Ghana under 17. I was the chairman of the under 17
which year?
Team 1995 mm-hmm. to Ecuador and won the World Cup. Mm. You know, it was a big thing in Ghana.
Huge, man.
Huge. When we won the World Cup to Ghana, we visited virtually every region because the late President Jerolis was so excited about the victory. He received us at the castle and ordered that an aircraft should put at our disposal to fly the cup to every region in Ghana imaginable for people to view the cup that we had brought from Ecuador. Mm-hmm. And then eventually, I'm sure that was in my interest.
Yeah.
But the story that I want to tell was that we introduced a new vocabulary to football generally in the world, because when I was in Ecuador, I was interviewed by the world press. They asked me, he's a leader of delegation, chef de delegation, as they said. How come that your boys play so well? What do you eat in your country? But these are small boys and they play so well. What are they eating in Ghana? I said, in Ghana, we eat certain things. I don't know the names in English, but we eat ka, nga, wa, adidoy.
Ka, nga, wa, adidoy.
So,
okay.
And then I told them we had a song that we devised there, and the song was Boshi Boboshi. Boshi Boboshi. So after now, I don't know why that has been our name. It's Boshi Boboshi and Fiano. Kojo Fiano had it. So we had these people there, and eventually, when the next term was over, they started to look for a president to run the FA. And in those days, the government of the day had a say.
Yeah.
So the Rollins asked that it should be given to me to run as the president of the FA. That's how eventually I got to be the chairman of the Ghana Football Association.
Okay.
And of course, day after, after Bedi Pele, Sike Okoro became the captain of the Black Stars.
But tell me, while you're vice chairman, so you had stuff to do with Black Stars as well.
Yes, yes. We sat on the Black Stars.
Senegal 92, you were there?
No, that was just Senegal 92. I came just after that.
After that, yeah.
Yes, I came just after that.
But you worked with Abedi Pele?
Oh yes, Abedi Pele was captain at the time I was on the GF. You know, first of all, Abedi Pele is a longer story than this. Abedi Pele worked with me when I was chairman of the RTU.
That's why I brought the name.
We got him. He was then playing with us, and then he left. He left for Benin, and then got injured, and then eventually he was better. Then we had one Mr. Ademako, who came and said he was going to help RTU with finances and other support. So he helped us to recruit Abedi Pele back
from Benin.
To RTU. Mm-hmm. And so from us, it was from us that Abedi Pele went, Abedi came earlier and then went to Qatar. Mm-hmm. And then after Qatar, a few movements here and there, then Ademako came and got him recruited back to RTU. It was from RTU that he eventually went and relaunched his career in France mm-hmm. and rose very high to Marseille and so on and so forth.
Mm-hmm. So, some of the experiences you had being GFA chairman and the turns in in. What has changed between your time and now?
Well, what I would say is that not much could have changed. But I think now we have the possibility of recruiting Ghanaians who are doing well in Europe to come and join the Black Stars.
As players, you
mean? As players. If we handle them well, I think we can go places. Already, for the coming AFCON, I think players like Didier Drogba are saying Ghana is the team to watch. And I believe that of all these Amateurs and so many other people who are now playing for us, if we put our act together, very
but
well.
How about developing the local capacity? You know, you just made reference to trying to get Ghanaians who are doing well in Europe, but you know, the potential in Ghanaians playing in Ghana.
Yeah, that potential is always there. I would not say I don't support it. Yeah. But the problem is that the training that we get at the club level in Ghana might not be very professional. That will enable them to meet players who are well psyched up. The word is psyche. From other jurisdictions, okay. But the same Ghanaians, when they go out to play in clubs in Europe, they pick so many things that are of benefit, and their confidence levels rise. Mm-hmm. And that is why most of the time we expect that they should do well, go out and come back, and then play for the national team. If we were not selling our players cheap, if we were all agreed that Ghanaian players should not go out, but even there. We have a vibrant constitution and our laws are so clear. You cannot stop somebody from who wants to go and play outside from going out.
Yeah.
But then when we have players who develop themselves well and then eventually they get into Europe, by the time they come back, you see that mentally they're better off.
Okay.
You see that.
But again, let me go back. Being GFA chairman, vice president, vice chairman, vice. Apart from Abedi Pele, who are some of the notable names that you worked with in the Black Stars?
Oh, we had like I mentioned, Akuno.
Mm-hmm.
We had Mamadou Gago.
Gago?
Yes.
Then he must have been from the.
But eventually he played for the Black Stars.
Oh yeah, he did. Of course.
And he played very well.
He would be with the Bands team, right?
Early
90s.
They
did Scotland 91. Is that
I'm
correct?
Not sure Gago went to Scotland. Gago emerged from the under 20s, I think, eventually.
Okay.
Then don't forget the great Tony Yeboah.
Yeah, Tony, yeah.
Yeah, he was in Leeds.
He played
for the Black Stars.
Yeah,
that was the height of the Pele Tony Yeboah fracas, as they said.
Wasn't that imaginary?
Well, you cannot be too sure. I don't want to start any debate, but people thought that there was a bit of rivalry between them. But they both don't agree because their wives were very great friends, and that I know very well.
Wow,
Abedi's wife and Tony's wife were very good friends.
Wow.
So I think the media would have overblown it.
Well, we love to do that, don't we?
And of course, we went to South Africa. We thought we should do well. Somewhere along the line, Zambia aged us out, and that was it.
Which year is this?
That should have been around 96.
96, okay.
Just after apartheid.
Oh, yeah. So this will be before that.
But in that match, I sat behind Nelson Mandela.
Ah.
Yes, because they put the Ghanaian delegation behind him. I think they trusted us a bit. And the story I have to tell, I don't know how to put it nicely. It's very difficult to put it nicely. Mm-hmm. But I decided to visit the washroom just before the end of the first half. And I made a mistake and I entered the great man's washroom.
Ah.
Unknown to me. Even I can see that you are worried for me. as if it just happened. So I was there when they announced the break. And the security came banging at my door. Here was I, in the big man's washroom.
Oh, wow.
But there were two spots.
Yeah.
But this man was great. He said, no, whoever is there, you leave him. He came and stood next to me and did his own thing with
That's
me.
That's all.
And went out. There was no issue at all. I turned and looked and said, what? This well, me today standing by the great man.
I'm telling you. But tell me, you know, what, again, your own recollections of what we now came to be known as the Bokum disaster?
Yeah, Bokum, that was just before I came on board.
Mm-hmm. I thought Bokum was 96.
Yes, I came 97.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that was just before I came on board. When we suffered all those things. I didn't meet the only biggest issue.
I thought you were vice president at the time we did the Bokum.
No, I was not there then.
Okay.
Now, what I think was of value was the World Cup we missed when Morocco came to play in Kumasi, and then we couldn't win that match, and that cost us a lot. I don't forget it. I was then the chairman, and when we got to Kumasi, there were so many stories that people are turned against us, turned against Ghana, and we're not going to win the match. And I don't know, true or false, whatever it happened, eventually we lost that match, and that cost us. It was so difficult for us to qualify for the World Cup. That's why, on this occasion, the former chairman, Kosi Nyantichi, had done his part by qualifying us successfully to the World Cups. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, some Ghanaians, no, I won't say all, don't appreciate what he did. But I think he did a lot for this nation in terms of the qualifications of the national team to the World Cup, because that definitely raised our image. Yeah. To the point that we were rubbing shoulders with Brazil, with Germany, with America, beating them in some instances.
In 2010,
we were very close. I was
were
that
the team to look out for.
Yes, you know, I was at that match.
Oh, so you're there in South Africa?
I was right there in South Africa. Yeah, I was right there in South Africa.
That was a close shave.
Very, very, very close shave.
That was in Johannesburg, right?
Yes. If we had won that match against Uruguay, I'm sure we would have won, because everybody in the stadium has turned away from Bafana to Bagana.
I mean, I was there watching the match as well. You know, my most difficult experience is when we lost.
Yes.
When we lost, or when we couldn't win, let me put it that way. My journey from Joburg to Cape Town
was like 100 years.
Even from my hotel to the stadium, the people were still shouting Ghana.
I know.
Even though Ghana was not playing.
But Ghana.
But I think we don't invest in sports in this
country. Yeah, I agree with you.
I agree with you. We wake up and we expect to win laurels at the highest level, you know.
I agree with you. what I can say, getting to the tail end, is just that I tell people that the DNA of Ghana and Jamaica is about the same. Isn't it? Yeah. Nigeria, Ghana, Jamaica, Cote d'Ivoire, Senegal. Well, about the same stock. And we believe that all those who went to Jamaica were a stock from Ghana.
Yeah.
So if they do well in 100 meters, we too should be able to do well.
No, Dembanku.
Yeah, but the Banku gives us power.
But it makes us sleep too.
Yes, you know, but it gives us power, you know. I wish we had more time. I'll tell you more about the Banku. That's the carbohydrate. That gives us the power.
Too much is bad.
Yeah, don't take it and sleep.
Yeah, that's a...
Take it and run more.
Salaji, tell me, so at which point did you finally bow out of the civil service?
Oh, that was... I retired in 2009, officially. You know, in 2008, the interview gets interesting, but 2008, I wore an APP T-shirt. Mm-hmm. To a rally in Kaswa.
And it was all over the place.
And I was asked to step down.
Yeah.
So I returned from the civil service. But my minister then, the late... Major Kwashiga.
Oh, okay.
He said, no, you're good material.
Oh, you health. Got, yeah, that's health. Correct. Yeah.
He said, you're not going anywhere. I'm going to reappoint you as my special assistant. So I got appointed back to the civil service as special assistant. and now he empowered me. Now I became a politician.
Yeah, of
course. So I eventually ended up as a politician for the civil service.
Yeah,
that's how it ended up so well. So very,
wow.
Very, very well.
Wow. Yeah. So then after that you became the chief.
Oh, I became chief in the course of my work in 2006. I was chief director of Harbors and Railways. Mm-hmm. I was made a Liberal, and I've been in that position up to now. I advised both the King, the Yagmura, and the Kpemura, who is the Prime Chief. I advised both of them.
So tell me, as we try to bring this conversation to a close, what kind of Northern Ghana would you want to see in another 10 years?
I want to see a Northern Ghana that is respected. We need a certain balance in appointments as well. Today, I'm not saying because Abu Jinapo and I are from the same ethnic group, but he's performing.
No, I told him on radio. I told him right on radio.
He's performing.
You know, but
it's a
but,
fact.
But so is Asensu. Yes. The Bantam,
yeah, I know,
excellent guy.
Yes, I know.
So is Henry Quarte.
Yeah, I know.
You know, and we are quick.
Henry Quarte is my man. He looks like you too.
Okay, then I look like you. Oh well, we look like each other. Breaking news! I look like Henry Quarte. Yeah,
he's a great man.
I've met him sometime. Lovely.
Time.
He's, you know, so when we sit, where we sit, when we see work being done, we get excited.
Yeah. I was in the U.S. when I read about Henry Quarte. I came only from 2 years ago.
Oh.
And all the Ghanaians there were so excited that this is a new face.
Yeah.
This is a future president of Ghana. He didn't want to hear about it when they put it to him. But whether he likes it or not, he's a future president of Ghana. He should be on the lookout.
Henry, so you haven't asked for this, but it's coming from no less a person.
Yes, he should be on the lookout.
Lepora Alhaji MMD Jaola. But it's been great talking to you, Alhaji. We need to find time on other programs to still talk to you because there's so much you need to
take us
through.
A lot more.
But this is how far time will permit. And thank you so much.
And I wish City TV the best of luck.
Thank you so much.
You are rising very fast.
Thank you so much.
You have the quality. And life is all about quality.
Thank you.
And I believe that sooner than later, you'll be the CNN of Ghana.
Thank you. My crew almost clapped. Hey, thanks for watching. This has been Footprint. My name is Samuel Atamensa. See you next time.